Hi, welcome to Teardown Tuesday. Where is today's teardown? It's not up my sleeve, it's up my shirt. Yes, warning, nudity alert. This could get me banned from YouTube. Ta-da! Here it is. It is the, rip it off, the Polar Wearlink coded wireless transmitter. One of these fitness trackers. Polar, one of the pioneers in the industry, you know, transmits to a watch, you get your heart rate, all that sort of jazz. I know wearables are all the rage and, you know, stuff like that. But yeah, these were one of the original. So I thought we'd take a look inside, see what's in there. Probably not a huge amount, but you never know. Could be interesting. And I thought we'd hook it up to the scope as well, see if we can get the signal out of this sucker too, and maybe see how it's coded. Let's go. Now, if you haven't seen these before, it really is quite a nice design. As I showed, you can just rip it off here, and they've just got these standard studs here embedded in the chest strap. And the chest strap contains internal conductors, just going from there just to a conductive fabric type pad here, which you usually have to moisten first in order to get good actual contact. And once you start exercising and sweating and stuff like that, then you get a decent contact. But that's basically all there is to the thing, and it is quite a nice little module. This isn't the one we're actually going to tear down. I'm currently wearing it. This is actually the wife's one. We've got two, so we can actually compare them, but I believe it's absolutely identical. So just powered from a coin cell battery and very low power, and transmits on around about 5.5 kilohertz. So it, you know, it really is low frequency stuff, and I believe it's actually like a it uses a loose coupling scheme, so it's a magnetic coil coupling at 5.5 kilohertz or thereabouts. So the range is only like 0.8 meters or something like that. It's got to be within distance, and I'll link to a data sheet down below where Polar actually sell a little module that you can get that actually can get data out of these things. Well, data, you know, it's just pulse rate, that's basically it. But these are supposedly coded in some way so that you can use more than one in the same you know, area. So, you know, two people side by side and they don't interfere, that kind of stuff. So, yeah, they actually sell a little module, and they tell you in the data sheet for that thing that you have to enable it the right, you have to orient it the right way. So if your board is like 90 degrees to it, it's not going to be nearly as effective as like that. So I'd expect some sort of a coil coupling system, some sort of loose coupled system inside this thing when we tear it down. And this is the wife's watch here, and this one's actually connected through to here, because this one will just power down. If it doesn't detect that, you know, any heartbeat signal at all, then it's not transmitting. So this one's actually receiving from the one we're actually going to tear down on my chest at the moment. As you can see, it flashes up there to tell you that it's receiving the signal, and my heart rate's about 85. That is quite high for me, because I'm sort of animated, I'm talking behind the camera now and sort of moving around. So yeah, it's reasonably high, and yeah, getting higher as I keep talking here. But yeah, there you go. So that's the that's a receiver, but you can actually get a module that you can plug into your microcontroller or something like that to actually receive the data for these things. So I don't think it's terribly complicated. Probably some sort of you know, simple encoding scheme. It might have, you know, a random address of 256 or something. I don't know. Anyway, we'll find out. So before we do the teardown, let's see if we can actually get a signal this and actually detect it on the scope and find that 5.5 kilohertz carrier frequency and what sort of encoding they're doing. All right, let's see if we can actually get something on a scope. Just got my scope probe here. I thought about maybe we could do try the like a single loop on here and get that, but I think the signal level is going to be so low that we're not going to get anything. So what I'm just going to do is try and place it against my chest here, see if we get anything. Getting picking up 50 hertz crap here, of course, at the moment. But I've got it on here. I've moistened it a little bit down in here, and if we place it on there. Bill, hey, look, there we go, we're getting, look at that, we're getting some spikes. Let's go in and have a look. So all the tests I'm going to do here are just have it sort of attached like that, and well, actually, let's try the loop method, but I don't expect that to be particularly effective at all. Once again, like our 50 hertz has gone there, but oh no, there we go. No, we can get something. Yeah, there we go. We are getting them. I'm rather surprised at that. single loop there. Yep, that's good enough. I might do that actually to get rid of the 50 hertz. Because one thing that this scope, this Tektronix MDO3000 doesn't have, sorry, I'm not on camera, MDO3000 doesn't have is software low pass or high pass and high pass filtering as part of the math function. So, you know, really quite annoying. It's got all this advanced math capability, all sorts of fantastic stuff this thing can do, but it can't do any software filtering to take out that 50 hertz, which is kind of annoying. So anyway, hey, there we go, we're picking up some packets. Oh, I'm surprised at that single loop. I thought it would be too low level, but that works a treat. So let's have a look at the data. And I can show you that coil orientation thing. Let's, if I put it vertical like this, okay, bingo, hang on, yeah, there we go. Are we picking it up? Yep, we're picking up some of those, I haven't triggered off this right yet, but there we go. We're picking up some packets there of presumably the 5.5 kilohertz. We'll go in there and measure it in a minute, but if I put it sideways like that, it's not, we're not going to pick up anything at all with that. And I'm down at 1 millivolt per division there. So like really low level stuff. So check that out. Maybe we might use an open loop like that, because check it out. We're getting nice big packets like that. There you go. So I might do that. And of course that's not going to the orientation isn't going to matter a huge amount. So yeah, I think we'll stick with that. We'll just stick with the open loop thing there. So get rid of our ground lead and we can capture some nice packets there, and we can trigger off those too, real easy. Okay, so I've captured this, and it looks like we've got sort of three packets there, and it looks like this one here is missed. So at a first guess, maybe they're doing the encoding may not be like data inside of here. Like these packets look like the same length, but we can go in and have a detailed look, but a missing one. So maybe that's how, you know, at a first glance, they actually code these things. You know, each device has just a random code perhaps, or maybe it changes. Maybe it dynamically changes and hops around. Who knows? Anyway, I got no idea. So let's go in and have a look at this. We'll expand the zoom on our scope here. Let's go into the, there we go. Look at that. And we can have a look there. That's what I like about this MDO scope, is its wave inspector function is really quite nice. 5.39 kilohertz, there you go. So that is, yep, no problem, 5.46. Okay, so there you go. We're very close to the nominal 5.5 kilohertz. So that is correct. And how much data we're actually, how many packets, you can count those, or we can probably get the scope to do it. Let's do that. So if we go into the measure menu here and we go add measurement, let's have a look at the measurement type. Source, we want channel one, of course. We don't want a snapshot. This is, I hate these dual knobs here. It's, you'd never know which one to freaking, it tells you A, B, but it's just really is annoying. I hate the selection knob interface. It's just, why have two? All other scopes get one just fine. Anyway, we've got all sorts of cool stuff here that we can measure. And I think if we go down here, look at this. Edge count. So let's go rising edge count. I love the info display over here. Shows you what it's doing. So let's, you know, I don't know, positive. Let's just go rising edge count. So, okay, we'll add that to our measurement. I think it's added. Yep, there we go. Look at that. Edges. 23. So let's zoom into the other ones and see what we get if we use our control. See, and if I widen that window, is the count going to stay the same? Yep, 23. So it's pretty smart. It's counting those. It's doing a pretty good job. It's going to be off now because it's counting some over here. But that, see, and of course if you go in, yeah, it's only got 10, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, or 11, but maybe it didn't have the full cycle there or whatever. Anyway, so that's near enough. It can give us a comparison between the two. Anyway, I actually might go in there and actually count them, but, you know, how do you count the ones? You know, which ones do you actually count? It doesn't matter. I just want a comparative ballpark between these two packets here. So it's saying it's counting 23 there. So if we move across to this one over here, is it the same? Looks like 23. Yep, it's an identical packet. So there you go. So there's nothing really... I mean, you know, that could be the encoding, the length of that packet, how many cycles they actually have. I'll have to compare that. So just remember, this one has 23, and I can, I'll do that right now. I'll put the Weiss one on. Got to remember not to mix them up, which one's which. And we will see if we get an identical number of counts. So here we go. Let's capture it. I've put the Weiss one on. Hey, that looks... identical, and there we go, it's exactly the same. It's skipping that packet there, so that is interesting. If we zoom into that, let's see if we get 23. There you go, I got it. 23. There we go. Yeah, it's basically the same. So, and it seems to be like the same length. I haven't measured it precisely, but it's pretty close. I suspect, of course, that the difference between the coded pulses, packets, is not between these, but between groups. So if I go all the way out, let's turn that off, and I single shot. See, I have to put in roll mode. This scope again. I actually went to look for the roll mode in like the horizontal menu, couldn't find it. Turns out that it's you just lower the time base over here. Sorry, once you get to a certain, I think it's 40 milliseconds per division or whatever. Anyway, it puts you in roll mode. So here we go. So there you go. So my heartbeat is the difference between these two here. And I can do my patented lab jumping exercise and increase my heart rate. So I'll keep that exactly the same. And we'll do the patented lab jumping and come back. To do it, and here we go. Let's put it back. There we go, it's quicker. And if I calm down, anyway, you won't see it on there, but we can go in and do direct measurements. And yes, for these sort of measurements, you definitely want a big record length so that you can get big time scales and then zoom into the data. So I'm using 5 meg plus the high res mode as well, just to clean it up a little bit, do some boxcar averaging on the waveform. And I've also got the bandwidth turned on there. So input bandwidth, 20 megahertz limited. You know, I don't need 1 gig worth of bandwidth here. It's just going to make my signal noisier. And of course, if we turn on cursors here, there we go. I've set that between the two, the start of the two peaks there, and that of course is my heart rate, and it does change. I verified that 736 milliseconds delta there between my heart waveforms, but it's still heart pulses. That, you know, this is not like an ECG thing. You cannot get an ECG waveform out of this. It is purely just giving you a data burst at each pulse there, basically. So that's it. Yeah, I mean, it looks identical between the two units, so I don't know how they're coded. Let me strap the other one again on and try it. Here we go, I'll capture this again. And we can shift that waveform across. My heart rate has probably slowed down there a tad. In fact, it's slowed down quite a bit there. Oh, bloody annoying. Okay, so there we go, 668 delta, and but you know, look, it's missing that pulse, and then it gives us another two packets there. And of course, if we zoom into those, it's exactly the same. And I've cleaned that waveform up a bit, used the loop method again with the probe, and I'm getting the distance between those two, the time period. We're getting 44.8 milliseconds. Let's see if we get that with the other one. There you go. That's probably how they're encoding it. There's a time difference there between those. That one, the other one was 44.8, and this one is longer, as you can see. So I reckon that is how they're probably encoding it, because there's nothing inside the packets, right? They're all like that, you know, 32 cycle burst or whatever. So, and of course, the difference between the first packet and the next first packet is your heart rate. So that time varies. So this time in here, when they send the two extra packets, that must be, I presume, the way that they encode these things. So, there's probably, as I said, like, you know, maybe 256 different possibilities or something. But it seems to be exactly the same each time. Aha, look at this. I just plugged it back on and I just swapped it again, and this one's different. So I reckon it maybe chooses a random, or one of 10 or one of 256 or whatever, random time periods every time. It does that. Look, it's very consistent, okay? After it's powered on, by powered on, I mean actually detecting a heart rate and actually transmitting. So it's very consistent like that. It's incredibly consistent. Yeah, what? Look, I'll take the same unit. I'll unstrap it from my chest, okay? Leave it for, I'll just yap on for 10 seconds, and I'll put it back and see if it varies. So this is exactly the same module, and you saw it was consistent before. Let's try that theory. No. Is that the same? That's what it was before. Ah, it's going to make a dick out of me. But maybe I've got to leave it off for longer. But anyway, you can see, so I'll put the other one back on, and you can see that and this is, no, it's, oh, that's the same. And if it was skipping, and if it was changing that between heartbeats or something like that, you'd expect it to, you know, just by me refreshing it, you'd expect me to actually show that, but nothing. So I'll switch it back. Oh, this is getting ridiculous. Getting very tiresome, sorry. This is a very tedious video. Ah, see, that one's longer. Look, that one's longer. It was here before the end of the packet was there. So it's changed. It's changed. So I reckon, and now it's consistent. See? Yeah, so there's something going on there. Something definitely going on. Now, here's an interesting thing I noticed. Look, it says coded on there, but it's got 31 next to it. And the other one, maybe by sheer coincidence, is also got 31. So maybe they preset that code in there. And but as you saw on the screen there, it did actually hop around. It was actually changing. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's a combination of hard coding plus maybe some random hopping between power-ups. I don't know. Grr, there you go. It's even longer again now. It's past that graticule marker down there. So, you know, it's, yeah, it's changing all over the shop. But then it's incredibly consistent. Once it's powered up, no problems whatsoever. Anyway, that's enough playing around. Sorry, it got a bit carried away there. Let's open this sucker up and see what's inside. Don't expect a huge amount. As I said, I expect a coil in there, an inductive coil, because that's what this data sheet implies, is that there is a coil and it gets coupling between the two, and the orientation matters. So let's have a little squiz. Don't know if I have to take the battery. Oh, no, I don't think I have to take the battery out first. Hey, it pops open. There's our O-ring. Ta-da! There's our coil. Too easy. O-ring seal, of course, these things, you know, you can swim with them and do all sorts of stuff, so it has to be your O-ring sealed. It's got some crap in there, but there she is. We're in like Flynn. Yeah, we've got ourselves the coil there. I don't know. It looks like quite a few layers on there, so yeah, that'd be a few. I don't know, anyone want to count the turns on there? There's probably at least three layers there, I think. And oh, there we go, it's got three. That's interesting.
Just three? There's not another wire, matching wire coming out of there? No? Looks like there's somehow three wires coming out of that thing. Weird. Anyway, here's our contacts over here to our stud. That's a nice little system. They screw those in to bring those over to the pad. So I rather like that. Got ourselves a shield there. Looks like we have one chip under there. Looks like we have a crystal down in there, probably. I was going to say it looks like a watch crystal, but it's probably not. Can we lift that up? Or did... No, we have to undo that. So we'll take that apart. And not much else. Couple of caps. Looks like we've got a transistor. And, well, not a huge amount there at all. So, yep. Well, this is pretty much what we expected. Check out the test pads there, of course. There for the production bed of nails tester. So we've got ourselves our drive transistor here, our main cap here, this large value cap, it's going to form a resonant LC tank circuit with our coil here. So nothing hugely fancy going on there at all, pretty basic. The microcontroller is going to detect the heartbeat signal and then just encode it somehow and then just do a little burst transmission. Pretty easy. And there we go, not much else. I don't know if there's anything on the bottom of that. Probably not. I'd be a bit surprised. We don't need a huge amount more. Macro lens time to see that part number. You might be able to see it in HD if you're watching in HD, but I can't. Could be a pus. I can see that's manufactured by ST though. Yeah, it's certainly ST, but what is that? TR06-37B82D VP830? Sounds custom-y. And of course, by custom, I don't necessarily mean a custom ASIC. It could just be, you know, an ST microcontroller actually rebadged. That's, you know, likely what it is. I mean, you could start looking at the pinouts, get the typical ST micros. There's our crystal hooked up to there, so you know that the two crystal pins are there and, you know, so on and so forth. You know, power across there and there, so you can probably find out, if that was an off-the-shelf ST micro, probably find out what one fairly easily. Now, I had a brief look through the ST microcontroller website through the parametric search engine there and searched for 24-pin micros, which this one is, and really the only one I could find was the STM7260, and that is a 5-volt only part. It doesn't come in 3 volts, which it must, because this thing is powered from a single lithium coin cell battery, so it must work, you know, like 2.5 volts upwards. So, really, yeah, I don't know. Does anyone? And that device also is designed for USB applications, and the pinouts don't match. The, you know, the oscillator was on these two pins over here and not these two over here, so... Yeah, I don't know, maybe I missed it, but it wasn't in their low power series, wasn't in their ARM series. Wouldn't expect an ARM, of course, any form of ARM in this. It's got to be some sort of low power micro substance, something like that, but it could be, yeah, could be some custom silicon. Don't know. Yeah, if we lift the board out there, we can see that there's not much action going on the back there at all. It's just got some flood fill, some extra traces, and the contact pads for the battery compartment, so that is all she wrote. That's pretty much all I expected in this sort of thing. I just thought it might be interesting to, you know, just take a look. And also the coding scheme used as well, which we didn't discover a massive amount, really. It doesn't look to be anything fancy whatsoever. Now there's a thumbnail for you on the YouTube video. I've got to probe myself because you have to have it hooked up under here to get a response out of it, of course, and get it to actually activate and transmit. And I got a probe like this. This is great. I feel like Iron Man. It's awesome. Let's go to the scope. And there you go. That is directly on one side of the coil. Bingo. So that's actually what we're transmitting. And here we go. If I correlate between the transmit coil and what we're picking up with the inductive loop, of course, exactly the same thing there. Just wanted to show that. So we're down at 1 millivolt per division and we're up at hundreds of millivolts per division on that one, directly on the transmit coil. So there you have it. Not much of a teardown, more playing with the scope and just mucking around trying to probe the signal than actually taking a look inside. But if you have any further info on exactly, you know, what the what the custom device there is, or the micro that it is, then please let us know, or the actual encoding scheme used. But I, you know, on a quick Google, I couldn't find the document, just sort of got some, you know, that module, which I'll link in down below, data sheet for that from Polar themselves, that sell this little module that you can plug into your microcontroller. So you can actually, you know, get one of these transmitters, one of these, and you whack it on your chest, and you can, you know, have your little Arduino or your other wearable electronics or something else can do that. Like, you could have something like your chest, you know, beats. Kind of, you know, you could have like a big LED thing on your chest that beats in time with your heart or something like that, you know, a shirt that actually, you know, beats in time with your heart. Something, you know, really, well, that's about all you can do. Something time with your heartbeat, pretty much, because that's all this thing's going to do. But there you go. Hope you enjoyed that video, as quick as it was, or maybe not so quick with all that waffle at the start, measuring. Anyway, links below. Catch you next time.